Presentation show, Bring It On. I'm your hostess, Shin Ayong. This season, we started with 18 presenters from all over the world, and now we're left with the creme de la creme. Today is the redemption round, so there's going to be some sparks flying. So sit back, relish the competition, and learn more about the culture, tradition, history that make up our colorful world. Now let's say hello to our wonderful judges. First, she can sing, she can dance. She's a beauty. Let's say hello to Punita. Hello.
Hello. Good to see you guys.
He's ice cold, but can honor a good presentation when he sees one. Ilya, hello. And the mother hen of Bring It On. Let's say hello to our season one champion, Amy.
Mother hen.
For the first time on Bring It On, we have a Belgian who's head over heels in love with Korea. Let's welcome Julian. Woo-hoo!
Hello, everybody.
Julian, so welcome to our show. Please tell us a little bit about yourself.
Yeah, so actually, today my friend Robin was not enough for this show because this is such an important day. So they asked an upgraded version of him.
Ah.
So I come as a better version of Robin, actually. So hello, everybody. I hope you will just like me better than Robin. That's my only hope.
I have here that you were a member of a boy band some 10 years ago, and it was called Bonjour.
Yeah. You didn't know that?
I didn't know that.
No? Oh, it's so famous in the time.
Oh, really?
Actually, not really.
Never see you. Yeah, it happens by mistake, kind of. So I was part of a show where we did travel in all around Korea, and our producer wanted to, like, kind of use that theme as a group. So me and our two other friends did some songs about us traveling all around Korea and telling the stories that happened to us. And it did not work very well. Yes.
Oh, ah, so then can you sing for us a little bit right
now? Okay, let's move on.
No. Right now, can you sing?
Do I have to?
Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, the famous Bonjour.
Yeah, I just need 2 seconds. It's important that I stand up, though.
Oh, okay.
경사났네! 경사났어! 너도 나도 우리... Bring it on!
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, bonjour! Okay, bring it on. Let's move on with the competition. It's the survival of the fittest. This is our redemption round. So runners-up from the preliminaries and the runner-ups from the playoffs who had the highest score will make it to the finals. So let's meet our contestants. First, she's helped redefine what French chic is all about. Let's welcome back Sarah. Hello.
Hi, everyone.
Woo-hoo! Hello. It's been 8 weeks since we saw him from Poland, the adorable Matthew. Hello.
Please call someone.
Okay, welcome, Matthew. And, oh, she's been here last week. Let's say a hello to Melina. Welcome back.
Hi. Yeah. Woo! Woo!
Yeah, we're so eager to have our contestants back to our show. So welcome back. It's so good to see you guys again. Today is the redemption round, and I'm sure our presenters are ready. They're eager, and we know they want this. So you're going to see some sparks flying today. Okay, Matthew, I know there's a world-renowned musician from Poland, right?
That's true.
Oh. Music.
Oh.
So, judges, do you know who composed this song?
Sai.
Oh. Bonjour!
Justin Bieber!
Bonita!
Me!
Okay, stop being ridiculous. Okay.
Can you give us the first letter of the name?
C.
Tchaikovsky. That's a T.
Charlie Chaplin.
Oh, is it?
Polish. Polish composer.
Polish. Polish.
Chopin,
right?
Oh, that's right.
Oh. Ah. Yeah, there you see a picture of the famous composer, right? Everybody has heard of him, but please tell us a little bit about this famous composer, Matthew.
He had such a, troublesome life. And he liked loneliness, and he failed two marriages. But during this time, when he failed with his two marriages, he composed like his masterpieces.
Ah, so two failed marriages for him, but it's a great thing for us because we can enjoy
beautiful music. That's true.
Yeah, I didn't know that about him. Introverted, and
yeah,
he
was
likes
introvert.
Loneliness, right? Yeah. I mean, you seem a little bit reserved yourself, Matthew. Is that a Polish characteristic?
Or do you have two failed marriages behind
you? It's not. I'm opposite of him.
What? And moving on to Persian music. Melina.
Yeah, actually, we have our traditional music and instruments, and especially to celebrate the 50th diplomatic ties with Korea and Iran. Actually, Iranians, they played the Arirang, Korea's Arirang classic song. They played it with our traditional instruments.
Okay, so music does transcend the boundaries of language and culture. So talking about music, that was a very interesting talk. Now let's move on to the competition. Every week on Bring It On, we select a new theme. So what's the topic for today? Here it is. Right. Whether we realize it or not, architecture plays a huge role in our lives. And some of these architectural marvels help tell the story, the history and tradition of a country. So we were curious, what did our viewers think of today's topic? So we went out to the streets to find out. Let's watch.
Global interactive presentation show, Bring It On. We have our very own smartphone application so we can hear your voice. In season 4, we count the votes live in the studio so we can hear your voice better. You get to choose your favorite item.
I choose A because it's in France, and France has beautiful architecture.
I choose B because it looks gorgeous.
I choose C because I enjoy ancient history.
I choose the number C.
Also choose C because I enjoy ancient history.
I choose B. I think it's the most interesting.
I choose B. I think it's the most interesting as well.
I choose A.
I choose A.
I choose A.
I chose A because I've been to Paris before.
So we had a variety of opinion. Let's talk a little bit more about that. Judges, do you have any interesting architecture marvels or structures that you'd like to share with us?
Of course. Have you ever seen a picture of the Toronto skyline?
Nope.
I have not, actually.
No, I have not, actually.
Never mind then, I have nothing to say.
please.
No, the CN Tower, I'm sure you've heard of before. There's there's also a glass floor there, so you can stand 555 meters above the city and look down. You can also see Niagara Falls from there, which is about 100 kilometers away. And you can also do this edge walk.
Oh my gosh.
So you are securely attached to the CN Tower and you're free to walk around. It's very, very safe, but could be terrifying for those of you that have
my legs are giving out just by watching
this. Who would do it?
What about in Belgium, Julian?
Yeah, in Belgium, actually, during the World Exhibition. So in 58, we built a building called the Atomium, which is based on the elementary chemistry item. It's iron, actually. So you can see, this is like an iron element. Just zoomed like billion of times, actually.
Yeah.
This is like more than 100 meters tall. And inside you can see a whole museum explaining the whole construction, the building of it.
Wow.
And actually one of the sphere was named after a chemist named Ilya.
Oh,
really? Yeah.
Are we talking about the same Ilya?
Not the same. No.
Never.
Way better, actually. He actually helped humanity.
Wow, scientific building. That's great. And don't leave out Seoul, because we have some amazing architecture here as well. Seoul at night is especially amazing. If you can see, Gyeonggokbung Palace is one of my recommendations. Right?
It has a magical feel to it, I think.
It does. Yeah. It takes you back to the Joseon Dynasty, which is great. And the palace first opened its door to night visitors a few years ago. So if you go at night, you can see this amazing... It's like a perfect blend of tradition and the modern world. So I definitely recommend you going to the Gyeongbok Palace when you're in Korea. And not to be left out, France. You guys have some amazing architecture, right? The Eiffel Tower.
Well, our architecture is world-renowned, but these days the hype is more around green architecture. So you have buildings like the Musée du Quai Branly, which facade is completely made of greens, or the Flower Tower also.
Oh. Wow.
I don't know if you've heard about it. It's a guest house, actually, in the center of Paris.
Wow.
Yeah, it has green on every floor as well.
It must be a lot cooler than other places because of all of that, those plants.
The oxygen.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Okay. What about in Poland, Matthew?
And that's the house. It's 73 centimeters thick. And it's really good example. Like the person on the picture is the person who lives there, who was architecture, and he designed whole house. The house is 73 centimeters thick and has everything what you need inside.
So it's narrow but super tall.
Yes, it's tall and narrow but has everything inside, and it's really good example how to save space.
As a kid, I would have loved to live in a place like that.
Yeah,
exactly.
Every room.
The slimmest house in the world.
Yes, that's true.
The slimmest house. If you're 73 centimeters thick, it's...
Like this?
Yeah. It just shoots right up.
It's like two person cannot... Be next to each other, right? If it's me and you.
Yeah, just us.
Okay, that's amazing. It's a perfect example of utilizing space, right? A very creative way of doing that. What about Iran, Melina?
Yeah, actually, Tehran is famous for the art, street art. And actually, government has been trying to renovate the old image. So they have been teaming up with architectures to do some trick art, like basically to paint the walls and do some trick arts or use murals on the walls. Yeah.
Very colorful.
And they're expanding this project as well to other areas.
Wow. Well, nowadays they have like trick eye museums everywhere around the world. So just go into a street and look in at these buildings would be like a trip.
Yeah. Fun to walk around.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. So today we will be looking at these fascinating architectures from each country. But first, let's review our rules. And this is how our scoring system works. From the judges, 40%. From the Bring It On application, 30%. To studio audience, 10%. And the talkback session counts for 20% of the total score. Now, here on Bring It On, your opinion matters. Your vote counts for 30%. 30% of the total score. So log on to our Bring It On application and select your favorite item. But remember, if you're watching us on air, on television, voting for next week will be open. Please remember that.
It was not following the
Now, with that said, let's start the presentation. Today, Sarah will start things off, but I don't see her yet. So while we wait for her, let's watch a special video message.
Hi, Sarah. I just want to wish you good luck on your presentation. I hope it goes well. I'm sure you're going to do a great job. Hi, Ting.
Sarah, hi, Ting. You're doing a great job, and I'm sure you're going to rock it today. Bring it on.
Let can we take you on a trip to France so that we can visit all the beautiful architecture? Here we are.
Hi, Sarah.
It's really French.
Woo! How beautiful is this?
Oh, wow.
This is Notre Dame. It really feels like I'm in Paris now. This is one of the most famous places for tourists to visit because, well, it's beautiful. It's beautiful inside.
I think it is.
Yeah. It's beautiful outside, and it's also beautiful. I love having this little.
Yes, it is. It is a fake one. Right? It's written in Korean there. I can see it.
Hi, Korea. Not good at landing when I teleport. Anyway, back to our subject. So, France holds the world's record for tourists. It has 84 million each year, and a lot of them come for the architecture. So let me take you on a little tour, little introduction to French's Gothic architecture. So for the etymology, it comes originally from Franciginum opus, which is the Latin for French masterpiece. It was then renamed as Gotico by the Italians during the Renaissance. A little bit about the history. It was born during the Middle Ages in France, mostly in Ile-de-France, where Paris is, and also in Picardy counties, and then spread all over Europe until the 16th century. It's known to be an evolution from Romanesque, but it's caused a little bit of stir there. And it's mostly seen in churches, but also in castles, city walls, or bridges. Now, a little bit about the distinctive points. It's known especially about its lightness and its verticality and heights. Also, it allows a lot of lights inside the buildings, unlike before. And it creates a contrast of emptiness and fullness. Also, it's known for its arc-boutant, which is not only good for the aesthetics, but also for the structure, to help the structure. The arc brisé that you see all the time in Gothic architecture, and the beautiful stained glasses. A little bit about the notable monuments. You have the Chartres Cathedral and the Basilique Saint-Denis, which are the pioneers of the Gothic architecture, but also my personal favorite, the Notre-Dame de Paris, which is worldly known. It attracts 14 million of tourists each year. And it's not only known for its tourist activity, but also it has inspired a lot of musicals, films, movies, books, and etc.
Thank you, Sarah.
Thank you.
Time is up.
Okay. I was done.
That was a very creative way of going about your presentation. A little teleportation, right? That was very creative.
Yeah, I learned
creative.
This trick just before coming.
Okay, thank you for your presentation. Now it's time for question and answers. Judges.
So thank you for showing a lot of the most famous pieces of architecture, but I'm wondering about the lesser known hidden gems, if you can tell me some of your favorites.
Yes, somewhere that people don't really know and don't really visit when they're looking for Gothic architecture is right here, actually. It's... Sorry. I just said the name, I forgot.
Time's ticking.
The Saint Cathedral, sorry. It's the Saint Cathedral, it's in Paris as well. But it's a little bit more hidden, but as you can see, the stained glass are beautiful over there and it covers most of the walls.
Beautiful.
Mm-hmm. Also, I see you teleported, but us, we have to walk in. So do you have any good way for us to see all these places? Because I know there's so many, so.
If you're interested in regular tours, there are a lot of tours that you can find pretty much anywhere to go to Paris. But for the Gothic architecture in particular, you have a few companies that do also a tour of not only Paris, but France for the Gothic architecture, if you're interested in these.
Just for the Gothic architecture.
Yes, that's how famous it is.
Wow, that's interesting to know. Some travel tips from Sarah. I'll take the next question.
Well, you were talking about the Louvre before.
Yes.
So, in your opinion, do you think that modern architecture or Gothic architecture best, I guess, represents France?
Gothic architecture, definitely, because it was born in Paris, and then maybe it's evolved a little bit through the times. But if you look at modern architecture, there is not one thing that is only French and that you can only find in France. It's so different right. and various mm-hmm. in the whole world, actually.
Thank you for your questions and your answers and also your presentation, Sarah. And now it's time to vote. Let's start with our studio audience. Studio audience, please get out your smartphones and get ready to vote. And now it's our judges' turn to vote. Please get ready to cast your votes in three. Get ready to cast your votes in three, two, one. Press the buzzer. Two out of four it is. Amy and Julian voted for Sarah, but not Ilya and Punita. Let's hear why. Starting with you, Amy.
Well, I mean, she teleported for this presentation.
Yeah.
That's going the distance, yeah. literally. But no, I think you did great. You stumbled a lot during the Q&A, which was why I was hesitant to vote. But I think you could do better in the final, so I want to see you come back fighting.
Thank you.
And what about you, Julian? It's your first time on our show and your first buzzer, yay!
Yeah, I just wanted to press.
Right?
See if it was working, yeah. No reason. No, actually, like, what to say, first, I really liked the presentation, how it was done. The font, the choice of the picture mm-hmm. behind. She really wanted to make a Gothic theme and she really yes. did well at that. I think she was a bit caught up by the fact that the video took so long. And you could see when she came, she was a bit in a hurry. She was like, oh, I really need to do this. The video was a bit too long maybe for the presentation. But I was really impressed because as a foreigner speaking English also sometimes it's not easy to find the right words, especially when it comes to architecture. You don't really speak in English of architecture, mm-hmm. right? And when they ask questions, she still had answers to everything.
Right.
And I was impressed that she knew. So she really did a lot mm-hmm. of research about that and that got my vote. Mm,
thank you.
Okay, and what about you, Punita? Why did you not vote?
Your delivery was a bit weak. You did stutter a bit, and maybe because you thought of it as this is architecture, this is Gothic, this is something I learned from, you know, high school, and I don't know these words, but it's the same for us too. So maybe if you use simpler words for us to understand, then it would have been a bit easier for you and for us as well.
Okay, that was the opinion from our judges. Let's see what our studio audience thought of Sarah's presentation. Here are the total studio points for Sarah. From the judges, 20 points, and from our studio audience, 5 points for a total of 25 points from the studio based on her presentation. Good job, Sarah.
Thank you.
I'm a bit deceived of the points that I had. I don't know, I'm not sure about, I think Ilya had pretty good reasons, I'm not sure about Punita's, so I was a little bit confused.
Next up is Matthew. His presentation is about Poland's Palace of Culture and Science. But before we hear from him, here is a video message from his supporters. Let's watch.
Matthew, I believe in you. Give your best on the show. Fighting!
Hello, Matthew. Give your best on the show. Fighting! Woo! Oh. Woo!
Hello, I'm Matthew from Poland, and today I'll be talking about Palace of Culture and Science. So let's get right into it.
I wanna watch a movie and
here I have some video for you guys.
How can I?
Aha! There's a place to do everything at once.
Ta-da!
Theater, science academy, broadcast,
and you can see what's inside of the building.
Cinema, cafe, university, restaurant, post office, shopping mall? That many? This building? What is that place?
So the palace is placed in the center of Warsaw, which is capital of Poland, of course. It was constructed in 1955 by Soviet architect Lev Rudnev, who was traveling around the Poland and he was getting inspired. That time from like historical architecture from old times, But the construction was also inspired by American Art Deco. It's the tallest building in Poland. Building is 231 meters tall, including the high spire on top of the building, which is 43 meters. It has over 3,000 rooms inside with different for different purpose. And on the 30th floor, you can see the panoramic view of the city, because there is like the terrace. So you can see really nice view of Warsaw. Let's get inside of the building. We can find four theaters, multiplex cinema with 8 screens, and broadcast hall has space at the audience for 3,000 people. We have also exhibition center, swimming pool, Museum of Technology and Evolution, post office, shopping mall, beauty clinic, something for you girls, restaurants, observatory, and many others. Palace is landmark of Warsaw and also number one traveling spot for people all around the world. One of 1001 words architecture you must see before you die. And there are various tour packages that will take you around the palace, so don't worry, you're not gonna be lost. Over 8 million travelers is visiting palace in Warsaw per year. The building doesn't have a good history, but it's improving the reputation. Like, it's everything is in process. Not only public institution, but also has like really big choice of facilities and hold the culture activities like concerts and many different exhibitions. The building plays important role for people of Warsaw. And I want to say something about the bad history, because since it was given from Soviet Union that time, we didn't have really good relationship, Poland and Soviet Union. That's why the reputation between it's so. Thank you.
I thought that was an interesting note to end on, but later on that. Let's take some questions. Anyone from the judges? Yes, Julian.
Also, I was wondering, so there's so many stuff to do inside, and yeah. It must be at comes like a certain cost. So how much is the
entrance
fee? The entrance fee, actually?
If there's entrance any fee, just go inside of the building. There's no charge. But if you want to go to the 30th floor terrace mm-hmm. to see the panoramic view of the whole Warsaw, you have to pay around like maybe $5, maybe $4. Yeah, I'm not sure, but I think it's around this much. It's not so much.
Okay. Next question. Punita, maybe you have one?
I wanted to know why you focused more on the inside and their facilities and not the building and the structure itself.
I think because the facility inside seemed to be more interesting, but I tried to mix a little bit of this, a little bit of that, and I tried to balance between. Because I said also about the structure, it was inspired by Art Deco and Polish mm-hmm. architecture, and I said also what was inside. Yeah.
Okay.
I actually have two questions. First, does this building differ from other Polish architecture in Moscow? Oh, in Warsaw, sorry.
You Russian!
No, I can actually explain my slip, because there are a lot of... When I was looking at this building, I was looking at Moscow building. There are a lot of buildings
That's
in
true.
Moscow like that.
That's true.
Absolutely okay. 100% Moscow style.
Because the architecture is inspired Art Deco buildings in Moscow. They were inspired by American. And since the creator of the project for the building, he was from Soviet Union, Lev Rudnev, he got inspired by Moscow buildings. And that's like... Seems a little bit confusing, but
okay.
What's your second question?
I forgot.
Okay, then let's take some questions from our studio audience. Studio audience, can I see a hand? Yes.
I wanted to ask when it was built, what it was built for? Like, was it also for culture and music and like during
yeah,
the
yeah, yeah.
Soviet
it was
time?
Originally as a gift from Soviet Union that time to Poland from Joseph Stalin. And that was, that's supposed to hold like the culture side and also for some like government meetings, politics, and yeah.
Just one quick question. What year was it built in?
1955. It started from 1952.
Joseph Stalin was dead by
that
time.
The building opened 2 years after he died.
Okay, I sense that was a very trick question, but Matthew dealt that with grace, actually. So that's all the time we have for question and answers. And now it's time to vote. Let's start with our studio audience. Studio audience, please get out your smartphones and get ready to vote. And now our judges, please get ready to cast your vote in three. Now our judges, please get ready to cast your vote in 3, 2, 1. Press the button. Time's up.
What? Two out of four.
Time's up.
Two out of four.
Two out of four. Wow, there's some murmurs of surprises here and there. So let's hear why. Starting with you, Ilya.
That now, must have been a mistake.
Yeah, I would think that you wouldn't have voted.
Well, I would have. But 2 points why I voted. First, you got me with the answer for the date question, with Joseph Stalin being presented this building to Poland. And second one, you just don't deserve one vote. It's a two-vote presentation. You deserve 2 votes out of 4. For that reason, I voted for you.
Okay. Who knew that Ilya had it in him? Does he have a hard eye?
He has
a hard eye.
He does have a hard
eye. He does really?
What is happening?
He holds and everything. Wow. And what about you, Punita? You were all cheering when Matthew came up.
Yeah.
But you didn't press the buzzer.
No, I didn't think it stayed on topic for me. I thought it was all about architecture, but you focus more on what is inside. So it's felt more like what is inside a department store? What do we have to offer for you guys? And it wasn't really about Polish, you know, buildings and structures, which I wanted to see. Mm-hmm. So for that reason, I could not give him the vote.
Okay, so 2 out of 4 it is from our judges. Let's find out what our studio audience thought of Matthew's presentation. Here are the total studio points for Matthew. From the judges, as you can see, 20 points. And from our studio audience, 7 points for a total of 27 points are from the studio.
I was really happy actually Ilya voted for me, and it was less stressed than the first time because it was already second time, so I knew what's gonna be here. And I think I did okay.
Our last presenter is Melina. Her presentation is about Iran's Persepolis. But first, here is a video message from her supporters. Let's watch.
You know what, girl? I can picture you to be the finalist 3. So be prepared, be strong, and be sexy.
Melina, امیدوارم موفق بشی.
میدونم که مقام اولو میگیری.
Just Melina.
Hello everyone, once more I'm Melina from Iran, and today I'm here to tell you about Persepolis. So in Persian we call it Takht-e-Jamshid, and Persepolis English word comes from Greek language and it literally means the Persian city. So it's a complex palace founded by Dariush in 518 BCE, and it was built to be a great kingdom and the center of government for Achaemenian kings, and it actually took more than 100 years to build the entire building. But the glory of Persepolis was short-lived as it was invaded by Alexander the Great. It was buried under its own ruins in 1620 CE. Still, it is a magnificent historical site, and it was declared as a World Heritage Site by UNESCO in 1979. So basically, Takht-e Jamshid is 40 feet high, 100 feet wide, third of a mile long, and it's mostly made of halls, terraces, corridors, and a double symmetrical stairway. And it's famous to be mostly made of wood and very heavy big stones. So there are some questions and mysteries actually unsolved about the structure and the location of this magnificent palace. What is the structure? It is constructed along the 30th parallel. As you can see in the map, they have the same latitude with Egypt Pyramid Giza. And the question is, how in that time people without any technology that we have today, such as satellites, could be so exact in choosing the same latitude, you know? And the second one is about the structure. As you can see, the structure is a very complicated engineering system. It involves very heavy weight bearing, such as stones and wood, plus a very symmetrical, accurate architectural element. And especially, most notably, the sewer system of this palace is among the most complex ones in ancient world. And it was built to store the snow in the winter and use it in summer or spring for like either just living or festivals such as Nowruz, you know, the first day of spring, our new year. And according to research, every year, over 5 million people, tourists, visited Iran, especially to visit historical sites such as Persepolis, which is the most magnificent one. And this fact contributed over $2 billion to our national economies. And as you can see, so this magnificent historical site has both a huge contribution to our history and our economy. Thank you for listening to my presentation.
Thank you, nicely done. Now it's time for questions and answers. Judges. Ilya, you have your hand up, very polite.
Yes, I do. You said that it's located on the same latitude with the pyramids in Giza in Egypt, but you draw a triangle. Uh-huh. What's on the other point of the triangle?
Actually, in that time, because Egypt was considered as one of the most, like, I don't know, how would I say, like, it's like, they were, like, the best kind of engineers of that time. So they believed people in countries, they believed that if they chose that latitude, it has some reasons, you know? And actually, there were reasons for, basically, for, like, patterns, current patterns of winds and ocean. So, yeah, actually, it's not just Iran. Actually, there are other countries, such as... You see, where is that? In Syria, you know, even in China, they were making their special cities and special like places according to the same latitude because they wanted to be affected, you know, with the same benefits. Mm. So they were choosing that latitude. Yeah, there's triangle. Actually, there's more to this map.
Okay. Yeah. Do you think Iran got their influences from Egypt? Especially with their plumbing systems and things like that, do you think they were heavily influenced by Egyptian architecture?
If we put the latitude fact aside, I think if you look at the real architecture in the pictures, especially,
right.
These are actually totally Iranian and it's totally Persian. These have their own meanings. Like lions, they are like kind of how sign of like sun, you know? And lion is actually... How would they say this? It's like the power. It shows the power of the kingdom, you know? And those, like, humans that you see, actually, those are, like, supposed to be the guests that the king had in that time. You see, they have some stuff, and with their clothes and everything, they're kind of specializing some guests from some special countries and areas. So the architecture, basically, no, it's actually just showing the history. You know, it's mm-hmm. not affected by those. But, yeah, the latitude, and they were, like, the location was affected.
Okay.
Yeah, I wanted to know actually because it's been discovered in the 30s and only put it by UNESCO officially like in the 70s. Why did it take so long for the process actually to...
You mean the 1930s and the 1979?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, that's actually a really good question because when I was reading about this, it was discovered in 1930s. But the thing is, it's a very huge place, as I was giving you the dimensions and stuff. So they were not actually sure. You know, there's no exact answer for this on the websites or any research, but as I read and I understood, they were not sure because even in 1934, they discovered another palace of this, another part of it. So I think they were in the process, you know? Like, they could not do the whole thing in 1 year, and they were not sure what is the exact background and history behind this. So by the time they're, like, getting sure and, like, discovering everything, it takes some time, you know, up to 1979.
So these are just remains, right? There are...
Yes, okay. That's true, unfortunately.
Okay, it's time to vote. Studio audience, please get out your smartphones and get ready to vote. And now it's our judges' turn to make up their minds. Please get ready to cast your votes. In three. Please get ready to cast your votes in three, two, one. Press the buzzer.
Happy that I did not disappoint judges this time. It was really good. Actually, I'm really feeling good.
Perfect score from our judges. Wow, Melina, good job. Great job. Let's hear why, starting with you, Punita.
The reason why I voted because you delivered it in such simple, plain text for us to easily understand. And it was a lot of fun listening and learning about your subject.
And what about you, Amy? Why did you vote for Melina?
Well, of course I'm going to give you a vote. I think it was a really strong presentation. In terms of your delivery, I think you are a very engaging presenter. I think we were all really paying attention really, really well because you're very interactive in some way with your presentation style. So, great job.
Thank you. And Ilya, today, two times in a day, what is happening to this world?
The Julian effect.
Oh, it's bonjour. Julian effect.
It's a global
warming.
It's a bonjour effect. Okay.
It's a global warming. it's your third time on Bring It On, season four, right? I pretty much said everything during your previous presentation, so I just do the bottom line. Presentation is perfect. I want to see you in the finals.
Oh, wow. Okay, that's a strong compliment coming from Ilya. Okay, perfect score from our judges. Let's see if our studio audience agree. Here are the studio points for Melina. From our judges, 40 points. From our studio audience, 8.5 points for a total of 48.5 points. Now that is a pretty high score to get from this studio, but there is still the online votes left, which counts for 30% of the total score. So if you liked Melina's presentation, if you liked Sarah's presentation, if you liked Matthew's presentation, go on to our Bring It On application and vote for your favorite presentation. The online application votes count for 30%. 30% of the total score, so that is huge. Now, in the meantime, the extra 20%, our presenters will have to fight for it. Yes. It's time for the talk back. It's time for the talk back. It's a chance for our presenters to attack and fight back. It's an all-out war for that extra 20 points. Now, just to fuel that competitiveness in you, there's one spot left in the finals. One spot, okay? So it's an all-out war for that extra 20 points. Our judges will award 10 points, and our studio audience will award the rest of the 10 points. You have 3 minutes to outwit your rivals, and your time starts now.
Can I ask you something?
Yes.
Okay, you were talking about the building and everything, as your judges saying, about the structure, everything, amenities. But the thing is, you did not, first of all, talk about the history
because as our subject today is about the history, you know, and the tourist attraction. So you did not talk about the history. Could you please tell us more about the history? As I heard, it has a very sad history behind it. And Polish people, they do not think positive about this building, actually.
Like young people, they are okay, but people from that time, they don't think positive because that time Poland was really under big influence of Soviet Union, and we couldn't do anything. Our government was all corrupted by Soviet Union, and that's why the building, when it was given to Poland from Joseph Stalin, people didn't think positive about this building.
How about the history? It's not a very old building. How can you explain about it in a like story?
Two minutes remaining.
You're supposed to talk more about this history. And does it even attract tourists? Any tourists in it? You know, like do tourists
I
come to
like
just
it was
see that
more
building?
Like a mall and a place where you go to spend. What are the actual attractions for the public that comes here that is not interested in spending, but more cultural events that may happen over there, maybe.
Exactly,
the building,
we have malls everywhere.
The
we
building,
have it even
building itself, from outside, is really huge construction. If you go, it's really wide and really tall, and like also you can go inside, and there's like museums. There's like huge space inside. They use for museums and exhibitions. And not always you have to pay for this.
Those are something common, right? Everywhere has it. You cannot say that that's something special about exactly.
That's true, but there are some architecture like specialties about this building. Outside, there are like the
One minute.
And also different sculptures outside. So,
can I ask you a question about Please. The building? The Gothic is, right?
Yes.
And first of all, I saw that there's English Gothic, there's Romanian Gothic. And the thing is, the structure, you cannot actually say this is for this building. Because this, like building these buildings, it took a lot of architectural span, period.
It did.
And
it
like,
did start
it's
in
like
architectures, all of it.
Architectures, they were changing their mind and they were not following the
and where
former
did they...
architecture, you know, hopes
it
and
was
wishes.
Not, it was not following
so like
the other ones before. It was actually evolving from it by changing its weak points. As I was saying earlier on, the other architectural types had a lot of cluster. It was a cluster. There was no light. There was no
but the thing is, in one building,
everything
that changed. In one building,
the
style is slowly changing. If you look at just one building,
and
the style is changing.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
It doesn't
change.
Time's up.
They stop talking.
And her talkback session was also really good. I don't know how it's gonna go, but we'll see. That was really a nice talkback.
I just wanna say that Melina, she has really strong attitude to ask questions. So I just hope everything went okay.
I hope so. I can get some points, and I hope I can be the first for today and maybe get to finals.
Wow. The last one minute was a fierce discussion now, and it's time for our judges and our studio audience to choose their winners. So judges, please huddle up, and studio audience, please get ready to vote. All right, the result of the talk back. Who deserve your scores? Let's start with our judges.
Okay, so this was a long conversation. And actually, I believe in debates, there's two ways to win a debate. First is to make a very good point. And second is to attack your opponents with the right question. And in this time, it was kind of a one-side battle, really. Like, there were two people being attacked by one person. But I think I heard that before she did the same kind of strategy. But this time was way more gentle about it. So she actually took notice of what was said before, so.
So the judges, you guys vote for?
Julian.
Okay, let's try that again. So the judges, you guys vote for?
Melina.
Congratulations. We can add that 10 extra point to your total score. And now for our studio audience. Who did they decide on? The studio audience voted for Matthew.
Whoa.
Congratulations, Matthew and Melina. Now, voting's closed and we have the final score, so stay tuned for the final results. It's time for the final results. I have the final results in my hand. Now we've added all the points from our judges, our studio audience, our online voters, and the final talk back session. Now, as you all know, today is the redemption round, which means that you three were given more chances than any of our other presenters. Now, some might say that you got lucky. I say that you got here by your great presentation skills. But after today, only one person, the winner of today's episode, will cling on to the hopes of becoming a finalist. Now, today's runner-up and whoever comes in third place will be eliminated from the competition. Okay, so today I will announce only the winner. I'm only going to call one name today, and that person will or will not become a finalist. It all depends on next week. Okay, so, whew, I'm nervous. I know. Whew, whew. Okay, it was a fierce competition, and today's winner is... Today's winner is... Melina, congratulations! 69.54 points in total.
Judges, studio audience, Bring It On app, bonus point, and the final score.
Wow, you got a perfect score from our judges. The voters voted for you, and you also killed it at the talkback session. You still can become a finalist. It all depends on next week's results. You know how it works, right?
Yes, I do.
If your score, if your total score is higher than next episode's winner, you will become a finalist. So it's gonna be a pretty long week for you.
Yes.
How will you wait for it?
I will just hope so. Okay, no, I will not have a negative hope, but I no more option.
Okay, you just have to cross your fingers and wait. Okay, good luck, Melina. Hope to see you in the finals. And Matthew and Sarah, you gave a great presentation. How about another round of applause for our presenters?
Yeah!
Survival presentation show, Bring It On. On each episode, three presenters will introduce and promote their home countries, and you get to decide who gets to stay in the competition and who gets voted out. Now, today was the redemption round, and we're so close to the finals. One spot remaining to become a finalist, so tune in next week for more. Until we introduce all fascinating items from around the world, we will continue to bring it on. I'll see you next week. Goodbye, folks. So log on to our application and participate. Come on!